So today we are talking about the topic that is connectivity. And I would start talking about the connectivity of water with human body. And as you know, if you think about the shape of water as you find it in nature, you will see that it's not necessarily ready to use in our habit as we have it today. You normally need to connect with this, you know, with the mouth. So reality is that when you talk about connectivity, you talk about two entities or two parts that have different shapes, and you need to find and what's called an interface. An interface will go in a number of topics talking about interface with different examples. The best interface for doing what you need to do with water and the mouth is a glass. So the characteristic of an interface is that it has exactly the two parts, and it has two sides of the interface that connect with the two parts. So you have an adaptability, an adaptation to how the mouth is shaped, and the requirements of the mouth, and the adaptability on how the water is shaped, and how it can change shape also with the interface. So the use of them together will give you the ability to do something as simple as drinking. So in order to go in a more advanced application, let's say, let me introduce you very briefly the Large Hadron Collider, that is the particle accelerator that is in Geneva, where I've been working until 2007. So you see here the Jura Mountains on the left. All the line in red is this city, technically actually is the canton of Geneva. And the white circle is the accelerator that goes into geological and geographical areas. It goes across the border, is 27 kilometers long, and it is 80 to 150 meters underground. The tunnel looks like this, and the reason why I want to tell you about this accelerator is because in order to put together a machine like this, that is again a 27 kilometer long, on average 100 meters underground facility, full of high tech and based on high tech, it takes a lot of connections. When you look at, I don't want to give you too much details about how superconducting magnets is done, but in my tenure as a coordinator in the accelerator, I have been dealing with daily meetings in coordination with a bit more than 10 teams of engineers that were specialized in different areas. Of course, I could tell you how you can connect them, but I would rather talk about how you connect two magnets together. We have 1,000, there are 1,200 magnets underground, and they cannot move for more than for a fraction of a millimeter, otherwise the accelerator will not work. And you have superconducting cables that carry electricity in these magnets in order to be able to generate the magnetic fields. And in the size of a cable that is less than a centimeter in size, you have 11,000 ampere, that basically refer to a bit over 100 times more than the electricity you have at home. And as you know, that is lethal. So the problem is, in each filament of the superconducting cable, you have a continuity of the superconductivity, and you need to connect together two magnets, thus two cables, and there is no technology that is able to maintain the continuity. So you need to create what's called a splice, technically, that is basically the interface that makes sure that there is a continuity in the current. In practice, it looks like this. It's a bit technical, but the important part is when you have an interconnection, once in a while, you are required to check on it, to do controls. And so why is that? Because it's not enough to design a proper engineer, from the engineering point of view, but also in the common life, a proper interface, thinking that this will work in a good way, first. Second, even if it worked in a way as we wanted, what will happen is you will need to do reiteration in order to improve the way the interface is done. I want to tell you about generations. So what does it mean to connect generations? First of all, let me get you a quick explanation of my understanding of the Dunning-Kruger effect. Dunning-Kruger effect says that from going from not expert to expert, the level of confidence, of self-confidence, raises a lot at the beginning, and then it decreases with time. Why is that? Because the explanation of Dunning-Kruger is that the more you know, the more you realize that is much more that you need to know in order to feel comfortable with, and so your level of self-confidence go down. A typical the example to put it into the perspective of a career to then come to generation is that if you go from first job to retirement, you will see that you are more likely to be self-confident in the first job than when you are in the middle of your career. And this is something that I live on a daily basis. And I would like to use this graph in order to compare two areas that have a distance roughly of one generation. So when you look at in the first job, you basically look at the people that the colleagues that professionals like me tend to train on a daily basis and tend to collaborate with on a daily basis. I find myself to be in the middle, let's say, roughly. And of course, the level of understanding of the topics is not necessarily it has more experience, but not necessarily the self-confidence, because I know that it's not easy to have a full control of a topic. So the result of this is that when you look at the generation at the beginning of the career, it looks like this. And you need to be very careful in observing and seeing your result of your analysis, because reality is this picture was taken after this picture, in which basically you had the young part of my company that was trying to send information to all the participants of this group of senior managers that I will tell you in a second what they do in life, and sharing these in social media and in the press releases. Why is that? Because this picture was taken in October 2019, and this is my former office, so it's if I may call it like this, that it's the control center of control room, it's called, of the accelerator of CERN. And with my current investors, we and my company, we brought them in a visit at CERN and we took this picture. So it was a weekend in which we were actually working. So the important part about connecting to generation is about, first of all, is understanding, taking notes, taking details that are needed in order to interface in two different ways of interpreting information and deal with them, and selecting information and then add them to the experience management. Now, this sale, I would like to tell you how this work when you are talking about different level of management in different type of companies. So we have, as you see, a small bowl of water of water that represent a manager in a small company, and a large bowl of water that represent a manager in a large company or in a corporation. The difference between the two is that the manager in the large bowl of water need to know very well what happens about his sub-environment, so in a part of the water that surrounds him. The manager in the small bowl of water will be impacted by anything that's happening in the bowl. And this is, the small bowl of water is representing the small company. And so it's telling you that there is a big difference, there is an implication of the manager in all areas of activity of the company. The fact is, in a large bowl of water, you are not used by being affected to all events. And in a small bowl of water, you are used to have all your company under very good understanding. Of course, when I say bowl of water, I mean company. And here comes the dilemma. How do I use the corporate manager, highly specialized, that I find in the large bowl of water, so, and his skill in a small company where I have new information coming in every day in small companies, and they have a very high impact in the overall ecosystem of the small company. So, like the fish in the small bowl of water, right? So he feels all the small changes, and all the small changes shakes all the water in the bowl. So here is some food for thought. Think at the two bowls of water, again, as the two companies with different sizes. Now, think about which size we are talking about. A small company doing $10 million in revenues. Large company doing $1 billion in revenue. So a difference of size of 1,000 times. It tells you also, it's a benchmark also for the difference in size in number of people involved, so number of employees. If a manager tend to be always 5 to 6 feet tall, how do you visualize them in their relative bowl of waters? And how much are they impacted by any random event in the company they work for? So in order to connect, and if you are visualizing this, if you go back to the notion of connectivity, in order to connect the skills of the manager in the large bowl of company, you need to interface in a simple way. Listen, understand the different point of views, retain what is applicable in a small company, and adapt the notion to a small company. Thank you very much. I hope this was useful.